Anza, welcome back. It's time for a very interesting case study, transforming the agenda of a fortification legislation, an experience from Bangladesh. In 2013, in the midst of one of the worst phases of political turmoil, Bangladesh passed the Vitamin A Enriched Edible Oil Law to directly address the issue of micronutrient malnutrition, popularly known as hidden hunger. It was the result of years of advocacy, firm political will, and the relentless courage of multiple stakeholders that the law survived a high court stay, which was finally vacated in 2015 after a 14-month-long legal battle. The complex lawmaking process passed the test of public interest, public purpose, and reasonableness. The passing of this law not only promised a better micronutrient profile for the poor and marginalized, but also displayed the strength of the political will in shaping Bangladesh as a nutrition pioneer in South Asia. Without additional financial burden to the state, this self-sustaining and cost-effective market-based model on food fortification with state accountability emerges as a strategic fit for many other countries. To share more about this, I welcome Nutrition Man of India, Mr. Basanta Kumarkar. Fondly known as Nutrition Man, Mr. Basanta Kumarkar is an international development professional who has won numerous accolades for his contribution and has been conferred with the many prestigious awards like Global Nutrition Leadership Award 2019, Hero of the Decade for a Clean and Healthy India in 2019. Government of India recognition on contribution to Poshan Abhiyan, and many, many more awards. Sir, it's our honor to have you here with us. The virtual stage is all yours, sir.
Oh, thank you so much, Deepti ji. At the outset, I must express my sincere thanks to Economic Times for inviting me to speak about this important topic. And as rightly pointed out, this is a historic legislation, perhaps first of its kind in this century, in this region. And this also passed a court battle and also passed many tests like public interest, public purpose, and reasonableness. It has a lot of relevance in India, and I will share why it is so important for India to learn. So you can go to the next slide. You must have known about, or at least heard many things about the power of nutrition. The good nutrition is good life, and I always say it is a personal protective equipment. And if India has to achieve its demographic dividend, if India has to increase growth, productivity, GDP, reduce mortality, and supercharge its human capital potential, then perhaps nutrition is the key driver. So next slide. And specifically during pandemic, there is always a demand, and people have started recognizing the power of nutrition. This is the most important recent slide you must have known. As per the National Family Health Survey, in India, the anemia has increased over last 4 or 5 years. Obesity and overweight also has increased, and almost 24% women and around same 23% men are also obese and overweight. 67% children under 5 are anemic. If you see, I have given a comparison. This comparison based on the 2016 Global Nutrition Report data. 1% children in Germany are stunted. In India, it is around 1/3, around 35%. So in Australia, it is almost nil. In India, it is around 20%. Next slide. This slide has a lot of relevance, what I'm going to speak about, the fortification law. This is the slide related to micronutrient survey, where you can find the widespread deficiency of vitamin A, vitamin D, zinc, and folate. Not only that, children are also developing pre-diabetic condition. So India needs food fortification as a strategy to address all pervasive micronutrient malnutrition. Look at zinc. Almost 42% adolescents in Odisha are also zinc deficients. Look at vitamin A. Almost 20% preschool children are also vitamin A deficiency. So similar was the next slide. Similar was the case of Bangladesh, and where somehow I played an important role in setting the agenda and bringing this legislation in close partnership with government of Bangladesh and many civil society organizations. I will share that experience, but the larger credit goes to the current Prime Minister, who demonstrated a political will, who demonstrated a strong political commitment to set this agenda in 2013, when the country was also running through arson, violence, bloodshed, and many things. Another important thing I want to tell you, since I was closely associated with this lawmaking process, this law was also passed in the last day of the parliament. So you can imagine the commitment of Honorable Prime Minister and also many other policymakers. Next slide. So this is a landscape in 2011 and 12. You will be happy to know that the first ever Bangladesh micronutrient survey was somehow co-led by me, and India started that in 2016-18, but we started in 11-12. There we found almost 20% children or people, and in slum it was around 38% school children were also vitamin A deficiency. There was only one supplementation program, and we thought if we could bring out this law, then definitely it will benefit a larger population. Next slide. Why vitamin A fortification? Many of you must have known it reduces blindness, it reduces infection, it reduces mortality, it reduces morbidity. But more important is, why mandatory fortification? It could be voluntary also, but we deliberated a lot. At least it took almost 6 months to 1 year whether we'll bring the law or we'll just go for a voluntary fortification. But we brought out a consensus among policymakers, political leaders, that mandatory fortification has more beneficial in developing world like Bangladesh, and it is also same for India, because it can address equity, it can increase universal coverage, it can increase accountability, and address and save budget. And at that time, we thought if this law becomes successful, then we might do away with vitamin A supplementation program. Next slide. So one important message I want to bring here, that developing countries like India, Bangladesh, South Asia, Africa, and Latin American countries need mandatory law. And there are many evidences to suggest that mandatory law increases accessibility, availability, and also ensures quality assurance and quality control mechanisms more in comparison to voluntary fortification. So this is the history. I reached Bangladesh in the year 2011, completed that survey, micronutrient survey, by 2012. Then we disseminated the survey, and I'm just telling about the below line, the power of convening. So you can find that we could have also stopped our activity after dissemination of survey, but I didn't stop. I persistently took a challenge to bring this law, and one after another, I try to bring stakeholder for a alignment and message alignment. It is very important. It is very important. In a lawmaking process, perhaps you know, It is the most superior form of advocacy. And legislative advocacy requires cabinet approval, parliament approval, and also it has to go through many consultations and dialogues. So understanding that and having some background in India about policy making and also my own background about law, that also helped me to garner political opinion, policy opinions. And you will be happy to know that in 2013, we brought this law. Then government also assigned me to draft the SALT law, which was also brought out. Next slide. This is a very challenging slide. This was a challenge before me. This was a challenge for the country because lawmaking is not so easy. You must have recently experienced about lawmaking process in that agriculture law, what happened. So there are many push factor, many pull factor, but look at push factor. In a country like India, if we want to bring a fortification law, perhaps we can learn that it needs a support from consumer rights organizations, civil society bodies. It requires a support from media. It requires a support from executive, basically secretaries and cabinet secretaries. Certainly, it requires support from political leadership and also industry. So that was a factor which helped us. But there are also pull factors. There are some people oppose. There are other regions. Some bureaucrats also oppose because lawmaking is not easy. And food fortification law in a country like Bangladesh was quite challenging. For me, it was a life-threatening experience. There are many untold stories. And I always say, whenever I present, ki Rabindranath, there is a poem of Rabindranath, Ekla Chalo. So for me, many times I had to run alone, travel alone for this law. And in a country like India, if you want to bring fortification legislations, it could be for one commodity or generic fortification legislations, perhaps you need to look into strength, weakness, opportunity, threats, different challenges, risk, and mitigation measures. But what we did here, along with the government, along with other civil society, we planned the risk and mitigation measures. So it was a day-to-day affair and day-to-day engagement. In a lawmaking process, you cannot procrastinate, you cannot be delinquent. You have to be strategic, you have to forecast, you have to anticipate, you have to also engage, and everything has to be very transparent manner. Next slide. But one thing is common in lawmaking process, the community. If you could look into community aspects, community control, community related things, then definitely you will find success. This is the summary of law. Mandatory production, sale, supply, preservation, and marketing of vitamin A fortified refined oil. Law bans import of unfortified edible oil. We introduced for the first time quality audit in this law. If you go through that legislation, you will find a reference about quality audit, which is very unique. And later on, I also try to introduce that in India. Strong food safety, quality assurance, quality control. I think many of you are quite aware about food safety. It is not only about quality control, quality assurance is very, very important because across value chain, you need to maintain quality. Otherwise, the vitamin A content will be reduced. So there are many technical reasons for that. And government role in demand generation, awareness, behavior change, campaigns was also part of the legislation. So government allowed some budget into it. And regulatory enforcement was key. There was imprisonment, there was fines. Sometimes this clause appears to be very, very contentious. some industries oppose it, some policymakers oppose it, but this was one important clause. When this law was challenged and went to the court, somehow this clause helped us. And court realized that this is a public interest law. This is a law for the people. So you have to prove that. That is why I always tell that this legislation passed public interest, public purpose, and reasonableness. Reasonableness is about evidences. And this law was built based on evidences from micronutrient survey. This law was also developed based on the evidence from many other countries. As a policy analyst or a policy maker or as an advocacy person, you need to organize those evidences. Next slide. Now, why did it happen? How it was such a difficult thing could happen? I have summarized. There are many points, but I have summarized that you need centrality of operations. You need to keep on board even your opponents, those who oppose. You have to quote them. You cannot fight with them in a lawmaking process. So you have to bring all stakeholders. Centrality of stakeholder is key. If they start opposing, then there is a problem. Knowledge management means you have to gather evidences. Lawmaking is not just based on your whims, based on what you decide. It is based on data, fact, data-driven management, evidences. So you have to gather that in country evidence, regional evidence, and global evidence. And shaping political and policy options, I think all of us know. But as an advocate or as a person championing that, and at that time you can imagine I was a foreigner to Bangladesh, but somehow they accepted. You need to demonstrate humility, conviction, and spirit of innovation. So whenever you go and sit at the discussion table and convince a minister, there are many stories you can read. I have a published article, not only in India, but also in a big book about this law. So you need to go with knowledge, facts, and you need to be humble. And no need, one niche. So many of you coming from marketing background must have understood how you don't have to head on. You have to also build your own segment. Civil society voice is important because otherwise they will be antagonistic. They will be oppose you. Then it will be difficult. And change narrative. Whenever you are positioning any law, legislation, or any advocacy or policy making related to nutrition or fortification, it has to align with your country vision. It has to align with country mandate. It has to align with country policy. So then your political leadership can relate it. Then your policymaker can adapt it, assimilate with it. Otherwise, it will be difficult. And everything has to be very transparent and inclusive. Inclusive is very important. As I told, you don't have to leave many partners. Since you are familiar with this antagonistic environment and you know currently, this nutrition sector stakeholder and message alignment quite difficult, many parallel lines, many risks, many challenges. But I believe if you could do and pursue everything persistently in a transparent manner, using evidence, then definitely you will find winning result. And this is one such classic case study. It could be difficult, there could be challenges, but definitely you can get success. So thank you so much. I am open for any questions or any clarification. So it's my pleasure. Thank you so much. Over to you.
Well, thank you so much, sir, for sharing all that information and knowledge with us. Sir, I do not believe there are any questions right now.
Okay.
But yes, once again, it was a delight to have you here with us, sir. And thank you so much because you are indeed a powerhouse of all that information. So with that, dear delegates, coming up next is a very engaging fireside chat, which you do not want to miss. But before that, we have a small video for you. So let's take a look.
Thank you.